Hello, Google Plus developers, and welcome to this week's episode of Google Plus Developers Live. I'm Gus Klass, a developer programs engineer on the Google Plus team. And today I'm going to be showing you some best practices for sign-in. If you are watching our episode from last week, I had started out by just at the top of the charts, kind of where what you're trying to do with sign-in is get the user to sign in. And there's a couple of things that you can do to kind of encourage the user to sign in more and to increase the likeliness that they're going to sign in onto your site. And when you sign in the user onto your site, you get all sorts of benefits, like that user is then able to contribute to your site in an easier way. And you're able to get to that user's data, which allows you to draw the user into your site more. So if you look on my screen, you can see the site as it was rendered last week. And so this is just a copy of the demo from last week. And in this copy, you can see the sign-in button prominently displayed on the right of the screen. You can see that encouragement to get the user to sign in on the left. And when the user signs in, they get this nice experience where their profile is reflected back to them. And then it bounces to kind of draw to their attention that they're signed in. So here's the basic experience, and here's the better experience. So let's disconnect. So what I want to show you today is kind of the next step. What happens before the user signs in? And if you look at this site, I've made one change to the site, and this change is kind of a future-facing feature for IS2Q. And what this forward-facing feature is it allows the user to do something with their photos. I haven't determined what it is yet, but at some point I'm going to add a feature that brings in a user's photos from their Google Plus activity stream. So what I've done is I've created some code here that just does the basics, and it signs them in with Google Plus. Now, after the user signs in, now this icon appears in the top right. And that icon has this, you know, it's an indicating to the user that you click here and your photos will be accessed. So if you look at the photos here, you can see that here's all the photos that exist inside of my activities stream on Google Plus. And let's just take a quick look at the code for how this is done. We've actually shown very similar code in other GDLs, so I don't want to spend too much time on this. But this is code that we see a lot out there, and because people are doing interesting things with a user's Google Plus activities. So at a high level, what we do is we construct that Gappy client, and then we perform a request against Plus activities list. And we set the user ID to the currently authorized user, get their public collection, and then we traverse that list of elements that are returned, looking for images. And so this is just, I just have a string inside of my helper module, and that contains the URLs that at some point in the future I'll do something with. So now, what if, though, I want to get as many photos as possible for my users, and so I want to use additional data points? So what I've done is I've made another version that is better. And what this better version does is it also tries to retrieve files from a user's Google Drive. And in doing this, you're able to bring in more content for your site, and you're able to allow the user to get to more of their data without having to go through more effort. So I'll sign in again. And you can see that I haven't refreshed the page yet. But I'll sign it again. And now you can see an additional scope being requested. The little element here that says view the files and documents in your Google Drive has been added because I've requested an additional scope. And now I just accept. And now after the user signs in and the user clicks on this little icon here with the photos, you can see there's more stuff here. Most notably, the assets that I created for the site. So these are all these files on the top here are files from my Google Drive. So this is great. So now you have these two scopes, and you know, so you can do all sorts of additional things that you couldn't do before. Before going on, let's take a look at how we added that Drive scope. So here is the code markup for rendering that sign-in button. And on the top, you just see that data scope attribute, and it's set to just Google APIs auth plus login. Now, this is the Google Plus scope, and this is what is actually implicit inside of the sign-in button, but I'm explicitly showing it so that it's easier for you to read. And in the second case, what we've done is we've added an additional scope. So when you want to use additional Google APIs, you need to set up your console project to have those services enabled, and then you need to request both the scopes. So these scopes inside of that data scope field are just space delimited, and by doing this, we're then requesting both of those scopes. And so I'm also doing that photos list that I'm doing from Google Plus with the equivalent from Google Drive. And don't worry too much about this code. I just want to show that it's very similar, that it's very similar code when you're accessing content from multiple data sources using the Google APIs. So this just does a similar query where it says Drive files list. And then I'm looking for files by MIME type. And this will just return all the images that I have on my Google Drive. So we have both of these scopes. And when the user sees it, they then say, oh, I'm going to be I'm going to be granting this application access to both my Google Plus account and my Drive account. For some users, let's just say hypothetically, for some users, this could be something that would turn them away. And you don't want that to happen because you want users to sign in. So you can do something awesome. You can do something amazing. And you can actually do what I like to call dynamically generating these scopes. So let's turn it back to awesome. And reload the page. And so now, if you look at the page, you can see this sort of this signal that I'm giving the user when they highlight over this the sign-in button. The behavior is a little bit different. The button grays out when the user highlights over it. And now, when the user clicks the button, something different happens. I prompt the user, choose what you share with us. And I give them two options. I say, you know, I really want to see your Google Drive files because we want to allow you to do something with these photos. And but if you just want to use Google Plus and you don't trust us with your Drive files or you have sensitive stuff on there, you can just choose the other. So when you click this, the sign-in button then appears inside of the dialog. And when the user signs in, the scopes that they've selected appear here. So because I selected Google Drive, now I see view files and documents in your Google Drive, as well as the Google Plus scope. Now I'll cancel here. We'll go back here, and we'll render this again. And if I were to switch instead to say only Google Plus, and I sign in, I get just only Google Plus. So let's make sure that this is really doing what I think it's doing. And let's look at those photos again. So because of the requested scopes, I'm just now seeing my Google Plus photos. And now if I were to disconnect and reconnect, you will see that all my photos from Google Plus and Google Drive now will appear inside of that photos area. Now, there's a couple of things that I'm doing here, and there's a couple of things that are really worth mentioning. When you do this, you're losing a lot of the built-in functionality of the sign-in button. And you're losing it because you're managing this other dialog in addition to that sign-in button. So when you do this, if you choose to carefully select these scopes and allow the user to dynamically generate these scopes, make sure that you test the heck out of it, because there's a lot of simple ways that you can kind of do this and make the experience not as good. So let's see how I'm doing it. If I load up the code here, here is the first thing that I have to do when dynamically rendering these scopes is to enable explicit render. So what explicit render means is when the Google API script, when the JavaScript for the plus one button renders, which also contains the JavaScript for rendering the sign-in button, instead of just rendering the buttons immediately after the HTML is loaded, what you'll be doing is you'll be programmatically rendering that sign-in button. And so when you programmatically render the sign-in button, you then can do manage that scope attribute dynamically. So I also want to emphasize that Incremental Auth is something that's kind of more specific to, you'd encounter it in Android, and this is not that. This is just managing the scopes that are rendered inside of that sign-in button so that the user can selectively turn on or off some of those scopes. So here's how you do explicit render, the first part. You have to set the JavaScript, the Google API scripts in JavaScript to explicitly render that sign-in button. And so I'm loading the JavaScript asynchronously, at the top of that JavaScript client library boilerplate code, I'm setting that this global variable gcfg to have the attribute parse tags set to explicit. And then inside of my actual application JavaScript, I can programmatically render the button through this API call. And in my particular case, I'm storing the client ID and the auth scopes inside of that helper module. So this sort of simplifies it for me, but you can pass strings here, you can do it a number of different ways. And that first attribute that is passed to that gappy sign and render is going to be the target container that's going to render inside of your HTML. So I've just got a span inside of that dialog, and then I target the span, and as soon as I call render, the sign-in button appears inside of there. And I'm also doing something, so when I render those scopes, I just am, inside of that dialog again, I'm just going to append the drive scope to just a base scope that I'm using. And when the user says Google Drive and Google Plus, then that drive scope is appended to the scope string, and then when the button is rendered, you see both the scopes. And there's something else that I'm doing because of the way that I'm managing the dialog, I end up also having to do this sort of last bit of flair where I have to re-show that sign-in, that little interactive sign-in button by looking for when the user cancels the sign-in dialog, because I do something where I'm hiding the button around a lot and then re-showing it. So I'm not going to recommend right off the bat that you can do this, but you can do this. And I'm showing you just so that you can sort of see all of the various ways that you can really sort of flare up your site with personalization and a kind of a look and feel that's unique to what you like. So here's the sign-in button. Now, because I haven't yet rendered the sign-in button, what I'm doing is I'm showing this dialog with the sign-in button in the background. Now, when I click Google Drive and Google Plus, or only Google, the sign-in button renders, it hides inside of the background, and then it renders again inside of that dialog. And this is just something that I like. I just wanted to have the sort of experience, and I hooked into the various pieces of Google Plus so that here again, you can see that in the background, I'm hiding the sign-in button now, and I'm listening for this cancel event. So when I click cancel, there's an error that's returned to that on-signing callback. And in listening for that error, I can then show the sign-in button again. I'll try to talk a little bit more about this topic of things you can do when you're handling errors inside of the sign-in callback, but it's going to be saved for a future episode of the sign-in best practices. So this is really all I had to show for you today in terms of experience, but I have a great example of someone doing this dynamic scoping from the real world, Jolie Cloud. And if you look at their site, you see that sign-in experience that I've simulated before. So here's a sign-in button. Here's a sign-in with Google button that's prominently displayed on the front of their site. And when I click this, here is one of these dialogues. And you can select or deselect the features that you want to turn on and off. And when you do this, you feel like you can trust Jolie Cloud with the things you're sharing. So I really like when sites do this because it allows me to control up front the information that I'm sharing, and it doesn't surprise me. I don't ask myself, well, why is this site asking for access to my Google Drive? I'm suspicious of that. So by doing this, you can create a much more trusting connection with the user, and you can increase the likeliness that users will actually sign into your site. And once the users are signed into your site, then you have a lot of tools at your disposal for driving up engagement. So that's pretty much it for today's episode. I have a couple of announcements. The first is that the code from the last episode is now inside of our GitHub pages. So if you are interested in taking a closer look or running through the demo yourself, the code's there. And also, this week we launched PhotoHunt in C#. And so now if you are a Windows developer and are interested in taking a deeper look at Google Plus sign-in integrations, that sample is available for you. And that's it. So please watch our Google Plus Developer Live shows every Tuesday at 2:30. So thanks for tuning in, and look to see you next time.